All right, wild applause one time. Thank you, Jamie, Angela, Zach, and Co. Good morning. Happy New Year. It's 2019, baby. Somebody better smile for that. It's a new year. My name is John. I'm one of the pastors here. Excited to have you join us. We are in the midst of our annual week of prayer and fasting. We, for the past decade plus, as a movement, Greenhouse Church as a movement, have dedicated the first fruits, the very beginning of our years, to God, saying no to perfectly good food in exchange for perfectly amazing Jesus, because we think he's better than everything. And so you're like, why would you do that? It seems kind of crazy. Yes, until you experience Jesus and realize he's just better than everything. And so it's a good recalibration moment for our soul. If you've never dedicated time to prayer or fasting, I'd encourage you to try. Join us. Give it a shot. Tuesday and Thursday night, as Jaleesa mentioned in the video, at Calvary Chapel. Thank God for these churches who have been so hospitable towards us. Calvary Plantation Tuesday and Calvary Lighthouse Sawgrass United. Lots of other words and adjectives in there. On Thursday, all that info is, I believe the Tuesday night is info is in your bulletin. The rest is on the website. Are you guys ready? Yeah. All right, stand to your feet. We're going to get ready to read and honor God's word. We are finishing this morning. Everybody say, oh, this is the last sermon in the series called This Is Jesus. We have been hypothesizing and pontificating on the idea that if God were knowable, would you want to know what he's like? Anybody? Would you be curious here? And so the answer that scripture that God has provided is actually very encouraging, because if you've ever wondered what God is like, how he thinks, how he would deal, how he would interact, how he would feel about this, that, or the other thing, all you need to do is look at Jesus. He simplified it for us. And so this week, which is fitting for the season, as we dedicate our time, energies, and passions towards prayer and fasting, this week I want to look at what does Jesus have to say about prayer and fasting. Go figure. So if you turn in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 6, Matthew chapter 6 is where we'll be. Anybody excited for the national championship? Anybody? Anybody got Alabama? Who's got Alabama to win? All right, anybody got Clemson? Any Clemson fans? All you big faith people, I see. Anybody like, I don't know what you're talking about. I'm so confused right now. Okay, praise God. We got everybody in the mix here. It's football, okay? God's gift to mankind. Matthew 6, we're going to jump in. If you don't have a Bible, no sweat. We got it up on the screens for you, just to get us all on the same page. This is what is probably, and actually definitely, Jesus's most famous sermon. It's called the Sermon on the Mount. If you're new to the whole faith, God, spirituality thing, thrilled you're here with us investigating. We love that you're here. If you're wanting to know, where should I start? I've heard a lot about Jesus. My friend is always talking about Jesus. Where should I start reading about him for myself? Matthew 5, 6, and 7 would be a great place to start, because it's sort of Jesus's treatise on life in some ways. So we're going to jump in Matthew chapter 6. Are you guys ready for this? That was like half of y'all. I'm going to preach for like 2 hours if I don't hear more talk back. Y'all ready for this? All the college students are like, yes. Good to have you guys back. We missed y'all. Verse 5. Jesus is speaking here. He says, and when you pray, don't be like the hypocrites. Turn to a neighbor and say, don't be like the hypocrites. Nobody likes a hypocrite. Problem is, we all are them, but we won't talk about that right now. When you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, that they may be seen by others. And truly I say to you, they've got their reward. But when you pray, disciples of Jesus, followers of Jesus, when you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who's in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. When you pray, don't heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles or the heathens or the pagans do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Don't be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. This, then, is how you should pray. If you know this, say it with me. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. We can finish it. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Y'all so spiritual, look at you. Jesus continues, for if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will forgive you. Awesome. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your heavenly Father forgive you your trespasses. Just put a little pause here. What's the big deal about forgiveness, Pastor? I mean, I've heard all about it. Is forgiveness really that big a deal? Will you tell me, do you want God to forgive you? That one was for free. We'll continue. Verse 16, and Jesus closes here on this diatribe, and when you fast, don't look gloomy like the hypocrites, for they disfigure their faces, that their fasting may be seen by others. Truly, I say to you, they have received their reward, but when you fast, anoint your head and wash your face, that your fasting may not be seen by others, but by your Father who is in secret. You see a theme developing here? And your Father who sees what's done in secret will reward you. Would you join me as we pray? Jesus, you see everything. And you love us more than anybody else on this planet. Help us this morning. Speak to us this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Turn to your neighbor and give him a high five. Say, let's start the year right. You ever been with somebody really important? Some of you are like, I'm with somebody really important right now. And you're probably trying to date them. You ever been there? You ever been with somebody really important? You're like, wow, there's this feeling. I remember some of you, I've shared this before, but in between being a high school English teacher and a pastor, I worked for a charity foundation. I was an international consultant in Canada, which was cold, eh? And so I worked there, and I got a chance to travel to all sorts of different places in the world. But one of my favorite places to go was Israel. Now, I'm from a Jewish background, so in some ways it was kind of the motherland, right? And so going there, I was like, whoa, but how many of you have been to Israel before? Anybody? Okay, we're going to be taking a trip there. My wife and I think we'll be leading one next year, potentially in 2020. So it'll be amazing. It'll be incredible. There's a little plug for you. But there's something special about walking, if you're a Jesus follower especially, walking in the places where he taught, where he ministered, it's just incredible. And so I'm there in Israel. I was there for 3 weeks at one point, and typically I've gone with my parents. They've led for the past 2 decades plus these trips called Mercy Missions, which are part mission trip, humanitarian aid trip, and part tour, but I was there solo, and so I stayed with one of their friends and his family. His name's Eitan, and it was an incredible trip, and Eitan and his family, they're just great, but he's one of those guys that kind of like, you know, he's kind of jacked and muscular, and real handsome, you know, sort of like somebody you guys might, none of y'all are looking, okay, fine, whatever. It's kind of like Jamie Ricketts, and he's kind of one of those guys. He's real nice, but he's one of those guys that, like, if a fight were to go down, you'd be glad he'd be on your team, not on the other team. You know what I'm talking about. Like, not that I'm a pastor. I wouldn't get in a fight. I just called an angel or something. But if it happened, I would just be glad he's on my team. And so this guy, super amazing and great, but we've always kind of wondered, what does he do? Because he just kind of has connections that no one else seems to have. Like, the stuff's going down with the military, and he's just like, we can go to that base, and we can do that, and we can do this. And we're like, And then he's like, you know, and he just, everyone else goes to the airport. If you've ever been to Israel, you go to the airport, and it's like they lock down. They look at, like, every strand in your clothing, and they're like, what's your grandma's great-grandma have for breakfast in 2017? And they're just going through everything. He just rolls through security. I mean, he just, like, does stuff. And so we were like, I think he's like something, you know, like a secret agent, or I don't know what he is. Like, I think he's like, I was like, maybe he's like CIA, but they don't have the CIA in Israel. I don't know what it is. But I remember when I found out, and we were driving in his car. It was like this super cool, blacked out Suburban. There's like 3 of them in the country. Should have been a clue. And we're driving in his car, and he's like, hey, gets a phone call, and he's talking on the phone. He's like, Ken, which just means yes in Hebrew. And he's like, Ken. So he gets off the phone. He's like, hey, what are you doing right now? I'm like, I'm riding in the car with you. I don't know. Hanging out. He's like, all right, I have to take a work assignment. So you just need to, are you all right with that? I'm like, it doesn't seem like I have a choice. So I'm going to say, Ken, yes. And he said, all right, sounds good. Reach in the glove compartment for me. Reach in there, pull out like big police lights, put them on the window, All of a sudden, here we go, we're going, and we jump inside of like this big motorcade, like 30 motorcycles, blacked out Suburban, like we're like, here we go, jumping in this thing. And he's like, okay, don't be nervous. I need you to jump in the back right now, and you can't say anything. Okay? He said, we're going to pick up the ambassador from Micronesia, and he represents his entire country, and no pressure here, but the whole geopolitical nature of our relationship with this nation is at stake, so I just need you to not say anything. Okay. So I jump in the back, and I'm like, please, God, just don't let him see me. And so I'm back there. The ambassador, we roll up to this fancy hotel. Mr. Ambassador from Micronesia gets in the vehicle. You know the first thing he does? Turns to me and says, hey, what's your name? Like, oh God, I'm gonna start a war. Please, Lord, help me. And it turned out fine. He was a great guy. We ended up chatting. So I'm like, listen, I'm an ambassador for Christ, okay? I'm a pastor. So I represent heaven. You represent Micronesia, whatever. Now, I didn't say that because I would have started a war. I was very cordial and friendly, and everything turned out great. But I remember that feeling of like, whoa. Being with somebody of significance, being with somebody who represented an entire nation, being with somebody. Now, we all get this, right? Maybe not the ambassador from Micronesia thing, but we all get this idea of the significance of being with somebody. We've all experienced the power of being with the right people and what that can do for you and the way that can increase your trajectory in life. And we've probably all, unfortunately, experienced the similar destructive reality of being with the wrong people. Can I get an amen? Pastor Robbie, he's the executive pastor at Greenhouse Church in Gainesville, one of my heroes, one of my mentors. He always used to say to the youth, man, show me your friends and I'll show you your future. Why? Because who we're with has a dramatic impact on where we end up. You say, so John, what does this have to do with God and faith? I'm not really sure, but I'm going to figure it out by the end of this sermon. No, I'm just kidding. I would like to propose to you this morning that we were made to do life with God. And we've settled for life without God, and we've been suffering and scrambling as a result ever since. Like, think about it for a moment. Maybe you're here and you're sort of an agnostic, or you're from another faith background. Like, how do we explain the craving within the human race, spanning cultures and languages and demographic barriers and socioeconomic barriers? How do we explain all these world religions where people are clamoring for something outside of themselves? Something bigger than themselves. Maybe you're here this morning, you're like, John, I'm not a religious person, but I consider myself spiritual. Why? Scripture actually has an answer. It says that God has put eternity in the hearts of men and women. See, we were created to do life with God. You say, John, what happened? Well, what happened is what the Bible calls sin. Adam and Eve, our great-great-great-grandparents, our great-great-great-grandfather and grandmother, Adam and Eve, they were doing life with God in the Garden of Eden, in the book of Genesis. We know they're hanging out with God. They're taking strolls with God. But God gave commandments, and they broke this singular commandment. And as a result, sin, this word that the Bible calls anything going against God's path, his prescribed plan for humanity, this thing called sin enters the picture, and we've been wandering ever since. Trying in all of our own efforts and abilities and religious proclivities to try to get to God. And we're tired, and we're jaded, and we're frustrated, and we're worn out. And the good news is God has a solution for our wandering. And the solution is him. So I want us to take a look this morning at what Jesus, the wisest one, the sage, the image of the invisible God, what Jesus has to say about doing life with God. If you're taking notes, I would jot down my big idea or core premise for the morning is this. When it comes to figuring out how we were wired to thrive with God, the secret is the secret place. The secret is the secret place. We'll start in Matthew 6, verse 5. Jesus says, and when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites. Turn to a neighbor and say, don't be a hypocrite. Don't be a hypocrite. This is where Jesus starts. And I love Jesus because he doesn't mince words. He doesn't play around. He's not like, oh, man, I don't want to hurt people's feelings. He's like, hey, when you pray, don't be a hypocrite. He just goes there. See, this is what he says. He says, hypocrites, they might do the right things on the outside, but on the inside, their heart motives are twisted. He says, hypocrites, they like to be seen by men. Now, here's a problem. We all might get high and mighty, and maybe you came, and you're like, see, man, tell them about hypocrites, because no one's a worse hypocrite than Christians, and I might agree with you to some degree. Gandhi would say certain things. See, here's the disingenuous aspect of that statement. You know who are hypocrites? Christians and atheists and agnostics and Buddhists and Muslims. You know how I know that? Because at the core, you know who are hypocrites? Humans. I've joked before, I was like, we might as well change the name of this church to Ha. We call it Hypocrites Anonymous, because all of us, whether we like it or not, at a certain extent, Ha, here we are, hypocrite. We're all recovering from our hypocrisy, even when we don't mean to. And Jesus says, man, beware of this. Beware of people pleasing. Beware of this thing that happens that we all succumb to at different points, that we all feel the tendency to try to make yourself look good in front of people when you're actually supposed to be doing these things for God. He said, beware of hypocrisy. Because if that's what you're doing, Jesus is like, I'm not even going to say it won't work. I'm not going to say I'm going to come down from heaven and be like, smite thou. I don't know why that was my choice of what he would say. Jesus said, if that's what you're doing, that's fine. You just already got your reward. If what you're doing is trying to get people to think you're really cool, awesome, spiritual, amazing, great. You could even accomplish it, but it stops right there. See, the reward of hypocrites are the praises of men, the approval of men, the status in this life. People think you're so godly and amazing and spiritual and incredible and wow, look at you, and you get everything right then and there. Jesus was actually communicating to a specific reality within his own culture. See, there was this religious group called the Pharisees. Jesus came within a certain time period. He came to the Jewish people in the first century. And during this time period, it was a religious society that valued and venerated spiritual actions. And so there was this group called the Pharisees. They were really amazing on the outside. And they did all the right things. And is that Ariel and Yilma? What's up, guys? Man. Love you guys. I'm back with you. They did all this stuff and it was incredible on the outside and they looked so amazing and people would have thought, wow. And so what the Pharisees would do is they would go out in the street corners. They're like, man, I need people to know that I pray. And so they would go out in the street corners and they say, Father God, thank you that I am a prayer warrior. And they'd go out and they would make it so clear and apparent that they were connected with God and so religious and so amazing. And everybody thought that they were just, I mean, I can never be like the Pharisees or the Sadducees because, wow, they're so incredible. And Jesus says, no, they already have their reward. See, it's interesting because in Matthew 6, Jesus gets to the heart of what motivates people in their religious approach. And he says this, he says, listen, this is what the Pharisees do. This is what the hypocrites do. This would have been, by the way, wildly offensive to the religious establishment. If you're one of those like, stick it to the man, we're rage against the big brother machine, whatever it is, be like, you might want to check out Jesus again because he don't play. That was my theological treatise on Jesus and his theology. Jesus says, verse 6, but you, when you pray, man, go into your room, shut the door, and pray to your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret, what does it say? Will reward you. This is surprising. This is not what I would anticipate, and I don't know if this is what you would anticipate where Jesus would go here. See, he says, man, the hypocrites, they just go out and they do all their praying and they do all their fasting, and it's not about God, it's about them. And they just want to be seen by people. And you would almost anticipate Jesus to say something like, so when you pray, man, don't pray for a reward. When you fast, don't fast for a reward. Man, just do it. And Jesus doesn't say that. He said, listen, don't be like the hypocrites, but if you do things with the right heart and with the right reasoning, and if you go pray in secret, and if you shut the door, and if you make your pursuit of God actually about God, when you do that, what does he say? You're going to get a reward. Which begs the question, what is the reward he's talking about? You ever wonder that before? Jesus counterintuitively goes somewhere. So we know what the reward is of the hypocrites, right? We already talked about it. What is it? Talk to me. Applause, the praise of men, right? People are like, wow, you're so incredibly spiritual. Oh my goodness, I can never be like you. And you're like, oh no, praise God, humble brag, right? But you're like, yeah, you couldn't, sinner. You know, that's like, that's the hypocrite praise. That's a hypocrite reward. What is the reward of those committed to the secret place? Is it answered prayer? I think that's at least a part of it. There's all sorts of promises in God's word when it comes to prayer and answered prayer. John 15:7, just to give you a few, Jesus says, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. That's an incredible promise. Matthew 18, Jesus says, again, I say to you, if two of you agree on earth about anything you ask, it will be done by my Father in heaven. 1 John 5:14-15, and this is the confidence that we have towards him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us, and we know that if he hears us in whatever we ask, we know that we have the requests that we asked of him. I mean, these are just a few of the overwhelming theme in scripture of the power of answered prayer. If you're going into this week of prayer and fasting like, man, John, is this even gonna matter? Am I just talking to the walls? Is this just another version of wishful thinking and positive thinking? No, there's a God who's real and he's in heaven and he's listening and he actually answers prayer. But I don't think that's all that Jesus meant by the reward. I think that has to be a part of it because that is a theme in Scripture, but there's actually a more powerful theme in Scripture than even that. See, I think what Jesus is getting at is actually something deeper, is actually something a bit more mystical, is actually more profound and more powerful than even answered prayers. And the key is back in the verse I just read in Matthew 18. Jesus says again, if two or more agree on anything according to what you ask, it'll be done for them. And this is how he capstones this statement. For where two or three are gathered in my name, what does he say? There am I. Catch this. Jesus is like, man, if you get two or three together, it doesn't take a whole bunch. It doesn't take, you know, 10, 15, 20. You know, if you get some people together, man, anything you ask, God is there according to his will, right? He doesn't just be like, Jesus, give me a beamer. There's an application step from this sermon. You know, but he says, according to my will, which that's a whole other sermon in and of itself. But he says, listen, he gives this huge promise, and then he caps it off with, because wherever you two or three gather, there I am in the midst of them. There I am. What's the reward for those committed to the secret place who just seek God? For God, they get God. Like, do you understand this? I don't think we grasp that yet. Like, Jesus is saying, listen, if you've got things on your heart, if you've got needs in your life, if the craziness and the vicissitudes of life lead you to a place where you're like, I need a miracle. He said, great news. If you come together and two or more gather in my name, you get me. We've all experienced sometimes when prayers don't get answered in the timing or the way that we anticipated. But dare I say it, the overwhelming promise of the every single time reality of God is that, well, God is near to all those who are bowed down, to all those who call upon him in truth. His promise is his presence. Look at this in Jeremiah. God is speaking through Jeremiah the prophet to the people of God, to Israel, and Israel's just being crazy and ridiculous, and they're rebelling against God, and they're running from God, and he's like, what are you guys doing? This is gonna turn out so bad for you. We've already done this experiment before. And God says, listen, I'm gonna be real with you, and this is what I love about Jesus. Jesus isn't just some idealistic pie in the sky, just think better thoughts and life will be perfect. Jesus said stuff like, oh, in this life, yeah, it's gonna be horrible. But take heart, I've overcome the world. God says, listen, this is gonna go bad for you. I'm not even gonna lie. You're gonna get taken into captivity. You're gonna be oppressed. Your actions will have consequences that will be drastic and severe. He says, but you're gonna seek me. And when you do, you'll find me. When you seek me with all your heart. 1 Chronicles 28, David, King David, one of the great patriarchs, is communicating to all Israel towards the end of his life. If you know anything about life, it's as your days get shorter, your words become more and more selective. And so David, in this moment of communicating to his son Solomon, who would become King Solomon, and all the people of Israel, tells his son this: "You, Solomon, my son, know the God of your father and serve him with a whole heart and with a willing mind, for the Lord searches all hearts and understands every plan and thought. For if you seek him, he will be found by you. But if you forsake him, he will cast you off forever." David, the great patriarch, who had made some amazing decisions and some epic fails in his life, gets to the very end. He's communicating in front of all Israel and to Solomon, his son. And his number one piece of advice in the midst of everything he's learned in his entire kingship, which was arguably up to that point the greatest in the history of the nation, is: "Solomon, if I only got one thing for you, son, here it is. Know God. Know God. Be with God." See, friends, you and I were made to live life with God. And the secret is the secret place. See, I think oftentimes when it comes to the topic of prayer and fasting, it's very easy to slip into a mindset that God did not intend for us. And I need to let us know, church, and remind us as we're in this season of prayer and fasting, that we don't pray and fast to simply get things from God. We pray and fast to get more of God. We pray and fast to be with God. Now, I'm not saying you don't pray some big prayers and go for it and abide in him. All of these things are true. But if that's all we're going for, if Jesus becomes nothing more than a spiritual genie that we rub the little Bible lamp and say, "Hey, give me my three wishes," we've missed the point. See, the point of all of this is to connect more deeply, to like any relationship, deepen and strengthen our relationship with him through devoted time and energy, because a relationship with God is really just that, a relationship. My wife and I, Nancy, have been married a little over 7 years now, and she's amazing and she's incredible. I met a guy who was giving us some estimates for something at the Hub, and he was like, we were talking about whatever family, and I showed him a picture. He's like, "Wow, your wife is very beautiful." He's an older man, so I didn't have to fight him right there, you know, but I was like, "Oh, yeah." But I sort of took offense because, like, he was so surprised. Like, "Wow, how did you? Wow." I was like, "Man, God bless you. Not going to go with your company now, now. Just playing." But we've been married, and so we've gotten to know each other a little bit. And so a few weeks ago, there was a sale on what I think is God's gift to ice cream. Anybody had that, like, Talenti gelato stuff? You got to put a picture on it. Any of y'all had that before? Can I get a praise the Lord for this? Like, I want to do the deacon hum and start. Woo! It's anointed. If you've never had the pumpkin pie flavor and you like pumpkin pie, come on, somebody. Y'all better. If they want to sponsor me, Talenti, holler at your boy. I'll work it into sermons. Some of you are laughing because you're like, "I don't think he's playing. I think he really would." Hey. What was I saying? Gelato. Yeah, so I get home, and man, Publix is just so from the Lord. BOGO is like, BOGO got me through college. Any of the rest of y'all? Woo, wave offering. They had Talenti, buy one, get one free. I was just going to get one. I'm like, now I'm going to get four. Just because I feel like I'd be a good steward, you know, to like, I got to steward the resources God is giving. Don't judge me. So I was there, and I picked out the flavors, and I got four of them, and I got home, and I was like, "Babe, Talenti was on sale." She's like, "Oh, the gelato that we like, oh, yeah." She said, "Did you get?" And I said, "Butter pecan, or pecan, or however y'all pretentious people say it." I said, "Butter pecan, I got it." And she's like, "Oh, okay, but did you also get?" I said, "Chocolate chip cookie dough." She's like, "Yes. How did you know?" I'm like, "Because I'm the man, obviously." And then she rolled her eyes, because that's what happens. But no, how did I know that, though, right? It's because we've been married almost seven and a half years now, and I have not always perfectly and regularly, very imperfectly, but I'm constantly trying to be better. Have I covered all my bases, babe? I'm trying very hard to better and better do this. Learn and study my wife, because I love her. Because that's what you do in a relationship. And I don't want this to be like some hero thing on John. Like, I blow it in lots of ways as a husband. But every now and then I get the ice cream right. Because this is thank you. Thank you. I feel so supported, Michaela. Way to get the ice cream. I'm praying for your marriage. Because this is what we know about relationships. The relationships that develop and deepen only do so with intentional time, effort, and energy. And the relationship with God is a relationship. Which begs a question to you and I, with God asking with a smile on his face, how much do we do this with God? How did I know the ice cream flavor? It was being with her. It was picking the wrong flavor. It was exploring and listening and paying attention and forgetting and bringing home the wrong flavor a few times and coming back. And then finally, with all this effort and energy and thoughtfulness, it's finally coming to a place. And that's what relationships are. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 7 and 8, we're brought back to this point. Jesus says, when you pray, don't just heap up empty phrases like the Gentiles do, for they think they're going to be heard for their many words. Don't be like them. Your Father knows what you need before you ask him. See, the term here, Gentiles, it's also demonstrated as pagans. It's not making a diss on any people group. It's communicating that at that time period, the people of God were the ones that had the scriptures, which were the Jewish people, and you know, the rest were the nations. And so he said, listen, when you're doing stuff, don't just do it like the nations do. Don't just do it like the pagans do, where they're just trying to earn God's approval through their hard work and effort. He said, where they're just trying to make it happen on their own and get God's attention and make all these things come down or make him their magic deity to just get wishes from him. It's a reminder to all of us that God does not need our prayers. Did you know this? Like, God's not sitting around bored like, oh, man, my calendar's really blank today. I really hope some of these Christians or somebody starts praying because I got nothing to do. God's not like sitting around like, oh, please pray to me. God doesn't need our prayers. But we need to pray. Why? Because it brings us back into fellowship and relationship with him. It reminds of us of our total dependency on him. It's an area that we can exercise our faith without which it is impossible to please God. And at the end of the day, it is about changing us, not simply our circumstances. Here at Greenhouse, the vision is to be disciples. This is an intentional term that was used in first century Jewish tradition. A disciple would not simply be interested in what does the rabbi, what does the teacher know, and how can I pass the exam, and how can I get the information. The disciple was active in their following of Jesus. It's one of the reasons our mission statement, if you're new here or checking out the Greenhouse, is we want to help ordinary people become passionate followers of Jesus. And so as disciples, as followers of Jesus, we're given some explicit expectations of what normative Jesus following would look like. Two of those things are prayer and fasting. Jesus says right here, when you pray, I want you to do it like this. And when you fast, I want you to do it like that. There was this explicit expectation of it's not an if or if you find yourself in a moment where you're just like, man, I really need to diet. Why don't I be spiritual and call it a fast? Boom, there I go. He said, listen, you're going to do this stuff. So when you do it like this. Why? Why would Jesus say this? Is it because he was just looking to make good religious people? Is it because Jesus hated food and he was like, man, just skip all that? What is Jesus doing here? Obviously, this is not the case. It's because Jesus knows what we all know about relationships, which is if it's going to be a good relationship, it's going to take intentional effort and energy. And the way we build and the way we strengthen and the way we deepen that relationship with God is by spending time with him through prayer and fasting in the secret place. Turn to your neighbor and say, the secret is the secret place. The secret is the secret place. See, prayer and fasting is not about bringing God near to you. He already is. I think sometimes we think with prayer and fasting, we're like, God, you're so distant, but if I can do enough stuff, and if I skip Chipotle 3 days, and if I do, you know, then I'm gonna get your attention. No, God's already near. He's near to all who call upon him in truth. He's wooing us when we're stiff-arming him away. God's near to the atheist, waiting for him to call. Every good and perfect gift is from God. People have things from God. They don't even believe in him, and he's so good, he's giving it to them. Prayer and fasting isn't about bringing God near to you. He already is. Ultimately, it's about you drawing near to God. It's about saying yes to an invitation that was laid out to us over 2,000 years ago when Jesus died on the cross. It's about being with God and reminding your soul that God is with us. Emmanuel, God with us. So you say, what do I do with this, Pastor John? You're up there sweating, you seem all excited. What am I supposed to do with this? This week, I want us to devote ourselves to the secret place. This week, I want us to devote at the very beginning of the year, as we kick things off with all of our New Year's resolutions, as varied as they might be, I want us to once again devote or redevote ourselves to the secret place. You're like, awesome. What are we supposed to do there? It's a good question. I'm gonna give you three things, and if you're not taking notes yet, I'd encourage you to take these notes now because Jesus makes it super practical. What does it look like to devote yourself to the secret place, to not just pray like the hypocrites and the pagans, but to do this in a way where it's connecting with God, to be with God for your relationship with God? The first one is read the Bible. You're like, really? Is this where we're going? Step one, read the Bible in the secret place. If you've never read the entire Bible before, you should do that. It's a really great thing to do. There's some incredible life-giving realities and principles in there you don't want to miss. If you're like, where do I even start? We've got a Bible reading plan. It's on the bulletin. You can download the Greenhouse app every single week. It's literally laid out for you. You just follow along every single day. You'll get through the entire Bible in a year. Why? Because you need to know who you're praying to. If you've ever tried to have a relationship with someone and all you've communicated is via email, it's awkward because you don't know them. You're like, you're trying to read into their tone. You're like, they didn't do a smiley face this time, but they did one last time. So now are they mad? But the other time and emoticons, what? Should I do an exclamation point? Or you ever try to do that? You're like, I don't know this person. And the relationship never goes very deep when you don't know them. First thing is read the Bible. You want to know his promises. In scripture says that all the promises of God are yes and amen in Messiah Yeshua in Christ Jesus. But you want to know what those promises are. Doesn't do you as much good if you're like, all God's promises are yes. Well, what are they? I don't know, but I like that they're yes. Devote yourself to reading the word, to approach with confidence like we read in 1 John. Number one, read the Bible in the secret place. Number two, anyone want to guess what it is? Pray. Y'all are geniuses. Pray. Number two is pray when you're in the secret place. We toss out sort of a dream vision and goal that I have for this church is, man, if we could be part of a movement where we've got 1,000 people praying for an hour every single day, I think we could change this city and I think it could change the world. I think there's something powerful that comes from a place of submission in prayer. Maybe you're like, John, I pray like for my cereal in the morning. That's where I'm at right now. Okay, take a step. Maybe you start with 15 and 15, 15 minutes in prayer and 15 minutes in the Bible every single morning. Maybe you're there and you're like, sweet, I'm there already, I'm good. Okay, well, jump it up a step. Maybe go to 30 and 30 and you got your hour now, 30 minutes in prayer and 30 minutes in the Word. See, it's not about the number, but what we know about relationships is true about a relationship with God. With intentional effort and energy come depth and strength. Journaling is another great thing to do in prayer, to sort of write down, ask God, God, what's on your heart and what's on your thoughts for me? And then write down what you're hearing. You're like, are you going to hear voices? Yeah, Jesus' voice, because that's what he promised in the Bible. My sheep hear my voice, and I call them by name, and they follow you. The other thing is fasting. We're obviously sort of coupling those things together. Jesus couples those together here in Matthew 6, and I need to remind us of this. Christians, Jesus people, and if you're not a Jesus follower, you can just listen in for a moment for family time. We are not fasting to please God. Do we know this? Like, we are not fasting to please God. God is already pleased with us because of, that's the right answer, always in church, right? Because of Jesus. Like, when God looks at us, he sees Jesus' report card superimposed over ours. It's grace. And he's like, wow, you're amazing. And I'm like, me? And he's like, no, Jesus, but yeah, kind of you. And so it's like, we're not fasting to please God. God is already pleased. Fasting is about being with God. It's about being with God. Fasting sort of puts me in a different mode where I'm able to sense more deeply, more clearly what God is doing and what he's saying. Some of you know I geek out off of cognitive psychology and brain research. I just like it. And so I read an article recently where they're learning the power of silence. This is what the article was called, The Power of Silence. And what they're realizing is in an increasingly digital world like ours, where you're getting messages thrown at you 24/7 and social media notifications popping up and everything being thrown at you, they're realizing that you deeply need silence to stay sane. Can anybody say amen? You need a moment of pause to be able to step back and have mental health, clarity, and sanity to see and think about life more clearly. You know who thought of this first? God. See, fasting is like giving a moment of silence or pause for your soul. Fasting is where you say, I normally do this, and I rush to my lunch break, and then I rush to here, and then I grab this social media, and then I do this TV show, and then I'm moving, and then I gotta wake up early, and then boom, life. I'm exhausted. And fasting and prayer is about dedicating a season where you've got extended moments of pause and silence to step back and reflect and say, God, I'm here. You're here. Whoa, we're here. This is great. Is this great? Are we great? Prayer and fasting is a moment where you get to pause and the ladder you've been so furiously climbing, you get to step off of it and say, God, is this, I know I'm climbing real fast. Is this ladder on the right wall? I never thought to ask. It's this gift we've been given where God in his infinite wisdom says, listen, I love you. I'm not trying to shame you into a relationship. That's weird. That's ridiculous. I'm trying to give you life. And those answers you've been clamoring for, I have them. Let's talk. I'd love to share. See, fasting is about being able to recalibrate and refocus and reestablish God's authority, sovereignty, and priorities for your life. It is soul liberation. We look at the life of Jesus and we see that this is something that he did not just advocate, man. He lived this. All sorts of New Year's resolutions. Jesus says, man, seek first God's kingdom. He says, listen, the pagans, they worry about food and clothing and all these things. And he says, listen, I know, I got you there. Don't worry about that stuff. I'll make sure you have clothing. That would be awkward, okay? It'd be hard to follow me in like a nudist colony. I don't think that works, but I'm gonna give you food and clothing. Like, you're gonna get all that. But if you seek first my kingdom, all these things will be added to me. In the midst of New Year's resolutions that range the gamut and the spectrum, I'm proposing that we at least add in the one thing that Jesus ensured would change our lives literally in this life and for eternity. And Jesus lived it. Think about his life in ministry. When Jesus had to select the disciples, when he had to pick the people that he was gonna be with for his ministry and his life, what did he do? He prayed. He gets up on a mountaintop and asks God, God, who do you want me to be with? When Jesus was stressed and afraid, wrestling with this thing that he knew he was supposed to do, but he was genuinely terrified of it, he prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane. When Jesus was experiencing agony and pain on the cross, he prayed, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. If Jesus, who was God, was a man of prayer, I don't know about the rest of y'all, but I think I at least need to go there, and I probably desperately need to follow suit. This week, I want us committing afresh to the secret place, to get alone with God daily, shut the door, and be with our Father in heaven, because it is an invitation of a lifetime. I wonder how many of us are one trip to the secret place away from all anxiety and stress at our job losing its power over us. I wonder how many of us are one trip to the secret place away from all insecurities that have been trying to cripple us, being silenced because we grasp our true identity in him. I wonder how many of us are one trip to the secret place away from that clarity we've been so desperately lacking, that confidence that only comes from him, that peace that we've been longing for. Jesus says, but when you pray, go into your room, shut the door, pray to your Father who's in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. But here's the problem. This is hard. If you've ever tried to do this before, we start really well sometimes, and maybe you've even made this a New Year's resolution. You're like, yeah, I'm going to spend time with God. And then life happens, and it's a few days, weeks, months, and it's gone. Some of us have tried, and we kind of do it a little bit hit or miss, and some of us have tried and failed, and we've just kind of gotten disheartened and give it up. And it's nothing new to God. I'm going to close here. Worship team, you guys can get ready to lead us in a final chorus. I was thinking about Jesus in prayer, and the story came to mind at the very end of Jesus' life, right before he's going to go to the cross. In Matthew 26, Jesus calls three of his closest friends, and he says, listen, guys, he's wrestling at this point. He knew he was going to have to go to the cross to pay the punishment that our sins deserved. It was going to be agony on a physical level with the worst form of torture invented known to man at that time period. But even worse was going to be the separation from God Jesus had never known. And so he pulled his three buddies together. He said, listen, guys, I need you to pray with me. You ever been there before? Ever reached out to a few friends like, hey, man, guys, I'm going through it. I need you to have my back. So we're praying for you, man. We got your back, man. Jesus goes with his three buddies. You remember what they do? Fell asleep on them. Son of God. And they fall asleep. And Jesus comes and he says, come on, guys. Can't you give me an hour? Like, if you've ever felt the disappointment of being let down by people that you cared for and loved the most and were really counting on, imagine what's at stake is the salvation of mankind. And then I fast forward to the end of the story, and we're told various things about Jesus and what he's doing after resurrecting, right? He died, but he didn't stay dead, right? He rose from the dead, Easter preview, all right, coming soon to a theater near you. And so he goes back up to be with the Father, and we're told how he's amazing and he's incredible. And like Dale mentioned, he's coming back. Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus. But the question is, what's he doing now? You want to know what he's doing now? I love this. We're told in Hebrews what Jesus is doing right now. And it says that he's sitting at the right hand of the Father, never ceasing to pray for us. My friends, do you get this? This is Jesus, the one who in his moment of need, in his moment of desperation, in his most difficult moment on earth, reached out to his friends and said, hey man, pray with me. And they dropped the ball and fell asleep. And he dies on a cross for us because he loves us that much. And he raises from the dead. And the first thing he gets back to doing is saying, man, let me pray for them. You say, what's the big deal with Jesus, John? Why is it different than all these other religions? What's the difference? What's the distinguishing factor? Let me give it to you. The Word, God, became flesh and came down to earth. And we thoroughly disappointed him in every way possible. And when he got back up to the Father and had conquered sin and death, he said, God, I know they couldn't pray for me. I know they couldn't even give me an hour, but I love them so much, I'm praying for them every single moment of every single day because I love them. Friends, do you get this? This is the gospel, that even when we couldn't stay and pray for him, he continues and does not stop making intercession for us. No guilt trip, no shame, just an invitation to come and spend time with him, to build and strengthen and deepen our relationship with him, an invitation to come and know God. Wow. And he purchased it with his own blood on the cross. This is how we approach boldly. You say, John, I don't deserve that. If you knew my story, if you knew my track record, if you knew what I know about my love, listen, here's the reality. None of us deserve this. It's grace, and it's amazing, and you can receive it today. Why don't you join me as we pray? Jesus, thank you that you're so good, you're so loving, you're so merciful and compassionate that you invite us to be with you, to deepen and strengthen our relationship with you through prayer and fasting. And Jesus, that even in the midst of us forgetting about you, you remember, constantly remember and pray for us. You can keep your heads bowed and your eyes closed just for a moment of quiet and privacy before God. But if you're here this morning and And maybe it began this morning, maybe it's been a few weeks or even months, and you sense something happening in your heart. Maybe there's something saying, man, I think this is real. I think this is true. I think Jesus really is what I've been looking for, longing for, searching for. I want to give you an opportunity to begin a relationship with God right now. Scripture says it comes one way, and that's only through Jesus. If you'd like to receive his mercy, grace, and forgiveness found only through Jesus, I want to give you an opportunity to respond right now. And if you want to respond to that, to make Jesus Lord, leader, forgiver of your life, I just want you to shoot your hand up in the air and wave it at me. Say, John, you're talking to me. Awesome. 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 You can put it right back down. And right there in your chair, I just want you to begin to deal with God. It can be in your own words. There's no magic formula. Something along the lines of, Jesus, I'm listening. You have my attention. I am so sorry. I've tried to do my life without you, and I'm done with that. God, I want to do life with you. Forgive me. Jesus, be my leader. Teach me to follow you. Maybe you're here and you began a relationship with Jesus. You've been a Christian for some period of time, but you know the relationship is there, but it's not very good. It's not very deep. And the big thing missing is that dedicated time. If you're here and you'd like to recommit to being with God in the secret place, I want you to shoot your hand up in the air and wave it at me. Awesome. Hands going up all over the room. Lord, you see every hand lifted. God, we want to know you. We want to say yes to the incredible invitation to know you, God, more deeply. Would you stir passion, longing, and desire in our hearts? In Jesus' name, amen. So this is how we're going to close. If you're not standing, you can stand to your feet. If I could get some of our prayer partners and our altar workers up here at the front to line the front. If you're here and maybe you raised your hand and you'd like to begin a relationship with Jesus, or you just need prayer for something in your life, we've got an amazing team up here that they're just normal people who have lived life and made mistakes, but they know God. They've experienced life with Jesus. And as we sing this final song and Jamie and the band lead us in this final song of worship, we'd love to pray with you, encourage you, share with you some next steps in your faith journey. And I invite you to come forward as soon as we begin to pray if you'd like to receive prayer. Jamie, why don't you lead us?